Imagine your kid in lockup, without hope, feeling like you're in despair. Scripture talks of this condition. It says, hope deferred makes the heart sick. Oftentimes our kids are caught up in a cycle of hopelessness, of despair, of feeling like they're continually condemned to make poor choices. Just imagine what that would be like.
By the community, by and large, have been neglected, forgotten about. It's kind of swept under the rug. You know, we don't want to think about it. But these are the kids that we don't want hanging around our kids. I've heard that from parents in churches before when I was a youth pastor. We don't want these kids around our kids. They're going to be a bad influence. But I think these kids are representative of what's God's heart. He loves the least, the last, and the lost. He wants us to spend time with these kids, to encourage them, to love them, to come into where they're at. So much of what we do in churches, so much of what we expect, is we expect those who are on the outside to come to us. But I think that's the opposite of what Jesus expects. Matthew 25, Jesus says in verse 31, "When the Son of Man comes in His glory, and all the angels with Him, then He will sit on His glorious throne. Before Him will be gathered all the nations, and He will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And He will place the sheep on His right with the goats on His left. Then the King will say to those on His right, 'Come, you who are blessed by My Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me.' Then the righteous will answer him, saying, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you?' And the King will answer them, 'Truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me.'" To me. To Christ. Kids in lockup. God loves them so much. He wants us to be involved and sharing hope and healing. Come in the midst of this hopelessness and despair that sometimes these kids feel. In a cell just like this, I've talked with kids who've had a loved one pass away while they're in here. I've talked with a girl who was pregnant for the second time and who had suffered a miscarriage the first time, fearful that she was going to miscarry again. I've talked with young men who've had poor relationships with their dads or no relationship with their dads. I've talked with young men who have brothers and uncles and other family members in prison, and they're thinking, "This is my destiny." Hopelessness. Sometimes kids have been abused. Sometimes they've been knocked around by their parents. Sometimes they've been sexually abused. These kids need us. They need us to come alongside and spend time with them. Not just talk about the love of Christ, but demonstrate it. And one of the best ways to do that is simply to just show up and come in and be here. They're completely blown away when people come and volunteer their time. Most of the kids that we work with, the only adults while they're in lockup that spend time with them are ones who are paid to. It just means so much when someone comes like, "I will spend time with you simply because I care. I care. I love Jesus. And I want to show that love to you, and I care about you." In the midst of us volunteering, in the midst of having visitors come, in the midst of doing Bible discussion groups, in the midst of having volunteer chaplains and informal mentors and groups, we communicate the simple message to these kids that they so desperately need to hear, and that is, you matter to me, but more importantly, you matter to God. So I hope you get involved. These kids need you. They need us.